So I came to the conference with detailed notes on how to intro everybody. And for Mary, I only have a very short paragraph because one of the key things I want to tell you about Ms. Mary Manning, the moderator of this next panel, is that she is one of my board members. And she is also the captain of last night's Zydeco party. If you saw her walking around a sombrero, she's the one responsible for it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Look at her sitting there all calm, cool, and collected and sane. It's amazing. Okay, so let's get started. Mary Manning is the University Archivist and Curator of Performing and Visual Arts Collections at the University of Houston Libraries. Her research includes ethnographic interviews with Houston musicians, and she looks to grow the U of H Library's local music collections. Mary actively serves her professional community and recently served as the president of the Society of Southwest Archivists for the 2015-2016 term. Ladies and gentlemen, Ms. Mary Manning.
Hi, everyone. I just wanted to tell you a little bit about our session today. The session is called From Rhythm and Blues to Chopped and Screwed, and Folk Music Too. And it is about the popular music collections, archival collections at the University of Houston and at Rice University. The session will provide an overview of the Houston music collections in the University of Houston Library Special Collections and Rice University's Woodson Research Center. Learn about the development of Houston hip-hop collections, including the acquisition of the legendary DJ Screw vinyl collection and the underground music and culture behind the artifacts. Also learn about the Texas Music Collection, which is Vince's collection, which documents blues, country, and rock artists and the production and business side of business of music, including the African-American-owned Houston labels Duke and Peacock. From Rice, learn about the Houston Folk Music Archive, two words, which documents this vibrant singer-songwriting community from the 60s through the 80s, as well as some of the local music venues of the period. Our first panelist today is Vince Lee, who is the archivist for the Carrie C. Schuert Women's Archive and Research Collections and the Houston and Texas Collection at the University of Houston Libraries. In his first role, he collaborates with the Department of Women and Gender Studies and the UH Center for Public History. He was featured on KUHF's Houston Matter discussing the Duke Peacock records from the Texas Music Collection with Ed Mayberry and Chris Gray of the Houston Press. Vince is a past president of the Archivists of the Houston Area.
Thank you for that introduction, Mary. And since I am not as tall, I'm going to adjust this. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Vince Lee, and as Mary had just mentioned, I'm the archivist for the Texas Music Collection at the University of Houston Special Collections. The history of Duke Peacock Records started as two separate record labels prior to being merged under one owner. Oops.
A little preview.
Sorry, a little preview. There we go. That owner, as I mentioned, it started as two separate record labels, Duke and Peacock, hence the two icons. Thank you. Appreciate it. Before being merged under one owner, who is Don Roby. And you can't talk about Duke Peacock without talking about Don Roby, as their history is so strongly intertwined with one another. Entrepreneur, impresario, record producer, and with some controversy, songwriter, depending on which artist you would ask and if they felt he had ripped them off in the process, Don Roby was a chameleon, if not a controversial figure. Prior to Peacock Records, which he named after his bronze Peacock Dinner Club in Houston in 1949, his business empire would also include the Roby Hotel and the Buffalo Booking Agency, which would manage the careers of his stable of artists. There were rumors of his nefarious activities at his establishment, such as running a gambling racket in a back room of his Bronze Peacock Dinner Club, and of certain underworld dealings. He would definitely be what we would refer to as the OG or original gangster back in the day. He acquired Duke Records around 1953, which was based in Memphis, Tennessee, along with their stable of artists such as Johnny Ace, Bobby Blue Bland, and Junior Parker, and with the merger formed what we would know today as Duke Peacock Records. During the 1950s, Duke Peacock was considered the most successfully black-owned record business in America, and this was a good 7 to 8 years before Berry Gordy founded Motown Records in Detroit in 1960. Here are some documents found within the Texas Music Collection that show Roby's varied business interests. On your left is an income statement from the Bronze Peacock Dinner Club, listing its various expenses and net profit gained afterwards. On the right is an income statement for the Roby Hotel, which was located at 1307 Gillette Street. One bit of interest is a written notation down. I know it's hard to see, but if you were to see it, look at the document, it would mention something about a back room and said Evelyn didn't have it. So perhaps that's an allusion to the gambling operations at the establishment, but I'll leave that for you all to decide. Behind every great man, there's a great woman. For Don Roby and at Duke Peacock Records, his right-hand woman happened to be Evelyn Johnson. If Don Roby had an idea and a vision for doing something, then it would be on Evelyn Johnson to make the phone calls, ask the questions, find out how to go about doing it, whether it was drafting contracts for artists, pressing records for Duke Peacock, or running the day-to-day operations. She was also Roby's business manager at Buffalo Booking Agency, representing many of their artists, booking their performances at various venues around the country. But most importantly, I think she was an approachable buffer and sounding board for many of the artists, managing relationships and being someone who artists would feel comfortable approaching, as reflected in some of the letters found between them in the collection. Some of the genres of music which Duke Peacock produced were rhythm and blues, soul, ballads, rock and roll, and gospel, as exemplified in the diverse sounds of their artists. Clarence Gatemouth Brown was one of the first artists whose talents Don Roby instantly recognized as he performed in the Bronze Peacock Dinner Club, filling in for an ill T-Bone Walker. A guitar virtuoso, he's best known as a blues musician, but his styles have also synthesized old blues, country, jazz, Cajun, R&B, and also encompasses rock and roll, electric blues, and Texas blues. With its driving, swinging style and riff, Okie Dokie Stomp would be one of his signature pieces that he's known for. If you could cue the clip, please. Two letters concerning Gatemouth Brown. The one on the left, he'd actually penned himself to Evelyn Johnson, and if you were to read through the letter, you'd get a sense of his ease and comfort in dealing with her one-on-one. The one on the right is actually a letter by Don Roby to Andrew Mitchell concerning Gatemouth, what I would consider kind of some backhanded compliments. He mentions in the letter that Gatemouth is undoubtedly a great entertainer, but he's mixed up in the way he thinks, and if you go a little bit further below, he mentions that I don't know what he has in mind, but perhaps he knows what he's doing. So there's that tension between owner and artists, and they're trying to run their affairs. Johnny Ace was a rhythm and blues singer and one of the early stars of Duke Records, in which he signed with in 1952. He had a string of hits starting with The Clock, Yes Baby, Saving My Love for You, to name but a few. Unfortunately, he met with an untimely death at the age of 25 from an accidental gun accident. And here you will hear a clip entitled Pledging My Love, which was posthumously released after his death, December 25th, 1954. If you could cue that clip, please.
My love will be true all always and forever, I'll love just you. Just promise me, darling, your love in return. Make this fire in my soul, dear, forever burn.
Here are actually two telegrams regarding the untimely death of Johnny Ace. On left is a telegram from Evelyn Johnson informing his mother, Leslie Alexander, of the self-inflicted gunshot wound. On the right is a telegram from his mother instructing Evelyn Johnson to make all funeral arrangements for her son. Bobby Blue Bland, a Duke recording artist in the early 50s, was persuaded by B.B. King to enter the business. He earned the blue moniker because he believes in living the songs that he sings, using the blues to tell stories of love, loss, depression, being mistreated, misused, and put down in society. His philosophy was that in order to sing the blues, you had to have lived it to draw upon it. And here's a track entitled 362236. If you could cue the clip, please.
My baby, she looks so fine.
36, 22, 36.
Eyes on, hands off, but she's mine, all mine.
And I think he's describing somebody very shapely. Joe Hinton sang gospel for many years with the Blair Gospel Singers, then with the Spirit of the Memphis Quartet. In July of 58, he decided to change over to the pop field of music. He had many good pop recordings, but will be best remembered for his rendition of Willie Nelson's Funny How Time Slips Away. This track was released June 29, 1964. Hinton had a sound that was considered uptown soul, and his voice was a perfect fit for love ballads. If you could cue the clip, please.
Well, hello there. My, it's been a long, long time. How am I doing? You really want to know? Oh, I guess I'm doing fine. It's been so long now, but it seems long. It was only yesterday. Ain't it funny? It's so funny how time can slip right on away.
Hinton passed away August 13, 1968, at the age of 38. And here's a press release issued by Evelyn Johnson of Backbeat Records, a label also owned by Roby, detailing his passing. Signed in 1952 to Peacock Records, the Dixie Hummingbirds were from Greensville, South Carolina. They were considered one of the most consistently great gospel groups of the time and really put Roby firmly in the gospel scene. The track you're listening to is Don't Let Me Fall. Please cue the clip. Doesn't get you ready for church, I don't know what will. just to show it wasn't just all the guys having all the fun and glory at Duke Peacock, the women got on in it as well. Big Mama Thornton recorded Hound Dog prior to Elvis. Jackie Verdell, who started her career as a gospel singer from Philadelphia, transitioned to pop. She signed with Peacock Records during the early 60s and released 3 singles. Here's a lush ballad entitled Why Not Give Me a Chance. Cue the clip, please.
Are you lonesome and all alone? You have nobody to call your own. Why not? Oh, why not give me a chance?
With all the stars and sounds Duke Peacock Records were putting out during this period, there was a recording studio Duke Peacock would turn their business to, and it was local too. The Audio Company of America, and Bill Holford, gentleman on the left with the glasses and bow tie, was its president. Sound engineer by training, he as an assistant would run ACA from 1948 to 1990. At the right is a rate card with the rates for a range of services offered at ACA, such as disc cutting, studio use, recordings, processing masters, and disc pressings. At ACA, Holford kept master books, and the books document the master discs Holford would cut at a client's request, and these clients would include Duke Peacock Records, among other labels. Here's a page from one of the master books, which information such as the disc being cut, whether it's a 78 or a 45, the date it was cut, ACA number, track, and artists. Over a 42-year period, he and his associates would cut 6,014 masters at that location. Alas, as with anything in life and music, all things come to an end. In 73, at the age of 70, Robey decided it was time to cash out of the Duke Peacock holdings, which included over 2,700 song copyrights, hundreds of artist contracts. He ended up selling to ABC Dunhill for an undisclosed amount, but part of the agreement would have him remain as a consultant to his music catalog. Just as he began with his musical empire in 49, so it would end at 1975 from a heart attack at age 72. Before I close, I need to put out a few acknowledgments of thanks. First of all, to Mr. Andrew Brown, for the donor for the Texas Music Collection, and without which there wouldn't be a Texas Music Collection. Thanks also go out to Mr. Michael Corcoran and also to Roger Wood for writing about Duke Peacock, in which I have liberally borrowed facts, figures, and information from their writings. And I thank you, and I'll be sticking around for any additional questions that you have, but thank you for the allowing me to present.
It's now my pleasure to introduce my friend and colleague, Julie Grobe, who is the founder and curator of the Houston Hip Hop Collections at the University of Houston Libraries. It's the first archival collection to document hip hop music and the culture in the city in which it was created. Her other roles in special collections are coordinator for instruction and the curator of rare books. She authored the afterword for the book Hip Hop in Houston, The Origin and the Legacy, by Mako Faniel.
All right.
Okay, so why does the University of Houston Libraries have a Houston Hip Hop Collection? Well, in Special Collections, where Vince, Mary, and I work, we collect a lot of material related to Houston architecture, literature, performing and visual arts. And I had heard of the late DJ Screw, a DJ who was known for creating a new genre of hip hop. And it occurred to me that if someone had created a new genre in one of these other fields, we would have been really interested in bringing their work into the archive. So I thought it made sense that we try to collect the work of DJ Screw. There are some other reasons, too. Houston is known as one of the leading cities for hip-hop in the United States. UH itself is the second most diverse public research university in the country. There's a growing field of scholarship known as hip-hop studies. And finally, this was a good way to bring the stories of African-American men into the archive. So who is DJ Screw? DJ Screw was born Robert Earl Davis Jr. in Smithville, Texas in 1971. After a short stint of living with his mother in California, he moved to Houston and lived on the South Side with his father, who was a truck driver, during the 1980s. By 1990, he was DJing and, like most DJs, playing at parties and clubs. But what he's best remembered for is mixtapes that he created. And these were simply cassette tapes with a lot of different songs on them. But he put his own style on them, which was chopped and screwed, and sold them directly to his fans. So the screwing part of chopped and screwed refers to slowing the music way down. And he would do this first using the pitch control on the mixer between his two turntables. And then when he had a complete tape, he would put that tape in a tape deck and dub it onto other tapes. And in this process, he would slow it down again. The chopping refers to his technique of repeating words, beats, or phrases. And I think the best way to get a sense of chopped and screwed is to hear a song played the regular way and then hear a song chopped and screwed. So we're going to listen to a song called One Day by the duo UGK, which was made up of Bun B and Pimp C from the Port Arthur area. And let's hear this.
Well, 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 well. Hello, baby. Fool, one day you hear. And then you're gone.
So I start selling crack cocaine and codeine. Time to stack some paper, I gotta do it quick. Thinking I'm a juvenile, but they don't know who they messing with. Yeah.
Okay, so that was the UGK version, and now we're gonna hear the DJ Screw version.
One day you hear, and then you're gone.
Thank you.
messing with me. My mama's only son, and I live every day just like it's my last one. My mama's only son, and I live every day just like it's my last one. Body, body, mama, mama, why, why? Mimic, mimic, live, live, game and game and game, game, nah, nah.
He really takes that song and makes something fresh out of it. So that's kind of the basics of chopping and screwing, but there's a few other elements of the mixtapes, which were known as screw tapes. One is that there's usually somebody, DJ Screw or somebody else, emceeing or kind of hosting the tape, so we'll hear a minute of that.
Haters ain't gonna like this. No, I'm talking about.
He's gonna mention up, places he's lived now.
What's up, Southside? What's up, Quail Meadows? What's up, Smithfield? Yeah, we in the house. Houston, Texas. What nigga don't give a fuck about you, player hating buster having plexus? No, I'm talking about. Oh, what's a lot of player hate cuz niggas trying to imitate a nigga?
So he's complaining that people are trying to imitate his style, and they really were. His style got very popular and was imitated. So the final and very important element on the screw tapes is freestyling. And freestyling is basically improvised rapping. And we're going to hear a little freestyling from two guys who would rap on DJ Screw's tapes, often over an instrumental track. So there were a lot of people who would come to DJ Screw's house and rap on some of the songs. And so we're going to hear Fat Pat and Lil Kiki.
Watch a nigga pull wet in the air, fly the jet to Hawaii. Niggas can't try me or buy me. Don't try to get beside me, cause niggas too rowdy.
So freestyling is all off the top of your head while it's happening, like other kinds of improvised music. So I think the music of DJ Screw itself is quite interesting, but also the way that it was created and distributed is unusual. DJ Screw's tapes, and these were just cassette tapes, they were basically commissioned by people. So people would come to DJ Screw, say they wanted to make a tape. There would be a list made of songs that they wanted on the tape. Screw would record those songs. He'd have guys freestyle on it, usually the person who commissioned it and their friends. And then he would dub copies of that tape, and he would, you know, give the original to the person and sell the copies to other people. And originally, he sold them directly out of his house. So the lyrical content on the screw tapes has to do with things that DJ Screw and his friends were interested in. So they were interested in these cars called slabs, which tend to be older American cars like Cadillacs that have been highly customized. And they include things like rims that stick way out, and like this hood that's decorated with a neon phrase, and then there's a sound system in the trunk there. They also sing about a drug known as syrup or lean, and this is codeine promethazine cough syrup, which they would mix with Sprite in a bottle or a styrofoam cup, and something that became very associated with these guys. So the rappers who were on the DJ Screw's tapes began to be famous themselves, and they started to be known from the tapes. And as a collective, they called themselves the Screwed Up Click. And I love this album cover by Lil Kiki. The title is Platinum in the Ghetto, and that's because he was able to sell his music directly to people in the region who were into DJ Screw, who knew him from the tapes. So he wasn't going with, you know, major record labels, and he was making a living off of it. DJ Screw himself ended up releasing 4 albums with Big Time Records, and his music was really all anybody listened to in Houston. It spread throughout the region. With Napster, it started spreading around the country. And in 1998, he opened up a record store called Screwed Up Records and Tapes that sold only his music. And that store is still going. Now it's located on Fuquay. So DJ Screw's story has a tragic ending. He died in 1998 of an overdose of codeine, promethazine, and other drugs. And at least four of his friends died in a period from, he died in 2000, in a period from 1998 to 2007. Fat Pat and his brother Hawk were both murdered. Pimp C and Big Mo died of drug-related health issues. But his influence really lives on. He's influenced a lot of contemporary rappers, people like Drake and ASAP Rocky. You can hear that sound. Producers, hip-hop and R&B producers, really love that chopped and screwed sound, and you can hear it in music by people like Justin Timberlake and Frank Ocean. And Houston's own Beyoncé recorded this song called I've Been On, and if you go look for it on YouTube, her voice is pitched down to this, you know, screwed-up click-type growl, and she's talking about different things about Houston. So I want to give you just a brief tour of the kinds of material related to hip-hop that we hold in the archives. This is a little notebook that belonged to DJ Screw and has some lyrics on it. My favorite, he's talking about his own music, and he says, "He slowed the beat down and left a stain on your brain." I think the heart of our collection is the DJ Screw sound recordings, which is about 1,500 vinyl records that DJ Screw used to make his mixtapes. We also have the papers of Screwed Up Click member Hawk. And great thing in his collection is this notebook with black paper on which he wrote out his lyrics in a gel pen, like a silver gel pen. And then we have collections that aren't related to DJ Screw. We have the papers of Carlos Garza, known as DJ Styles. He was the hip-hop buyer for the store Soundwaves on South Main. He started out as a teenage b-boy and kind of wannabe graffiti artist, and he became a producer with Odd Squad and Devin the Dude. And we have this great image that his friend DJ Frosty Ice drew. And also there are some flyers from some of his teenage efforts. And we have the Peter Best and Lance Scott Walker Houston Rap Collection, which is based around this book project that photographer Peter Best and writer Lance Scott Walker put together about Houston rap. And it includes oral histories with many of the figures in Houston rap, and then these wonderful documentary photographs. This is gangster rapper Zero with his soy milk. And some guys out at the club. And our most recent acquisition is the full run of Ozone magazine, which covered Southern hip-hop primarily in the 2000s. And if you'd like to see more in these collections, the website is up here, and we welcome you to come visit us in special collections at U of H. Thank you.
Also, if you'd like to see other things from Julie's collection and Vince's collection, come by the Pop-Up Museum, because they've got a lot of great stuff on display there. It is also my pleasure to introduce Nori Guthrie, who is an archivist and special collections librarian at the Woodson Research Center at Rice University. Her current projects include digitizing audio reels from the university's student radio station, which a lot of us are familiar with, and starting the Houston Folk Music Archive, which documents Houston's 1960s through 1980s singer-songwriter community. Along with her colleague, Scott Carlson, she co-founded Indie Preserves, a website that gives preservation tips to DIY an indie music community. And she has presented at the South by Southwest, at South by Southwest on the topic. Without further ado, here's Nori.
Okay, let's get started. Okay,
let me move this down. Is that good? All right, perfect. All right, let's get started. So, how did we come up with creating this Houston Let me try this again. How did we actually get all this started? Okay, so in the summer of 2015, we decided that we wanted to begin digitizing our K-True Rice Radio, student radio, two-track reels. And so I met with a guy named Will Robdy from the station manager at K-True, and they gave us their Otari broadcast quality reel-to-reel player. And so in September of last year, I just started digitizing and going through, starting from the beginning in, '62 with Kennedy and moving on through. And then after a while, I started to realize that, wow, we have all this folk music. What is all this about? I'm not originally from Houston. I'm an Okie. And so I haven't even lived here that long. And so I didn't know exactly what this was all about. And so I kept seeing some names popping up over and over. And one was this band named Wheatfield. And the students, there were notes in there, and they were really excited when Wheatfield turned into St. Elmo's Fire. And I didn't understand what this was all about. If you could play the clip, please. And this is St. Elmo's Fire. So we had all this Wheatfield. We also had this other radio show called Arbuckle Flat that included guest appearances by Eric Taylor, Nancy Griffith, Danny Everett, Jack Saunders, Vince Bell. I could go on. And so I talked with our director, Lee, and I thought, well, maybe we should just try to see where this goes and see if we can contact people. And so we decided to start with what we had the most of, and that was Wheatfield. I talked to Craig Calvert of Wheatfield. I actually emailed him, and then he got back with me the same day and even called because he was so excited I hadn't answered his email yet. And he ended up coming in January of this year. And as you can see, here he is posed with some of the scrapbooks. He had recently started to go through his mother's materials, and she was a wonderful scrapbooker. And she made all these wonderful scrapbooks. As you can see, there's a poster of Caliban from their one of the first rock ballets that actually was here in Houston. And so it was this great collection, wonderfully visual. And so I was going through there, and there were a lot of names of other people, and so I just kind of started to create a list and contact people. And so we kind of had to first figure out how to define the collection. You know, Craig Calvert came the first day, and then the very next day, Danny Everett came. It was kind of crazy. And he's another folk, a local folk musician, and he was just like, well, you need to come up with a description and everything. And so I did. And we decided that we wanted to keep everything Houston-centered, and we wanted to focus from the 60s, which is kind of what's called the Great Folk Scare, and then moving into the 80s. And we wanted to focus on mainly on musicians and then people who were kind of connected to the scene and then also explore collecting with music venues. So now what I want to do is switch a little bit away from my kind of story that I've been giving you and let you know a little bit more about the kinds of collections that we have and then later on what we're kind of going to do to promote those collections, what our big plans are. So, of course, we have the Wheatfield here. Kind of covered this. Again, posters, beautiful images, and then also we have a lot of audio and video from that collection. Next, we have the Richard Dobson collection that we got in about April, I guess May. It literally came in a suitcase,
where he had stored all of these things. He packed them away before he moved away to, I just forgot, I blinked. But he's like Sweden. It's like, well, he's on the Rhine. He's on the Rhine. He has a little newsletter about it. Anyway, so we have a lot of great journals. The journal picture over there is actually from his touring with the Hemorrhage Mountain Boys and Towns Van Zandt on the great, the Monkey, I'm getting nervous, I'm sorry, guys, their tour through the Rockies. And then also their lyrics. He is a really great songwriter. If we want to, right before we start to cue this up, I actually did not choose a clip of something that he had written. I chose instead something of one of his close friends, Skinny Dennis Sanchez, who died back in the 70s. And this was one of his songs that he covered. And we actually have the correspondence of him writing back and forth with Mrs. Sanchez. If you could cue up the clip, please.
Bus stop coffee.
That's right.
Well, this is a Cage recording.
I'm drinking bus stop coffee. I'm eating bus stop pie. The coffee's just a little weak. The pie's on the stale side. It's raining outside of Memphis.
All right. We also have the Don Sanders collection. It's a smaller collection of ours, but we've have a good way to have supplemented it with a lot of K-True recordings. And then also I've been going out and picking up some of his albums. The clip we actually have connected to this is something from our K-True collection. In about 1975-ish, Brown & Co. actually wanted to drill in Memorial Park. Can you imagine this, that there would have been oil wells in Memorial Park? And when they had the big city council meeting for it, Don Sanders showed up with a couple of women, and he actually sang this song, if you can click this up.
Houston's Memorial Park, Houston's Memorial Park. Memory, memorial, remember with me how comforting a walk in the park can be. Mr. Brown says he will root for gas and oil, so gently he will barely disturb the soil. I say, if you feel fuel requires a sacrifice.
We also have a few collections that are kind of just coming in right now. One is the Linda Lowe and Writers in the Round concert series collection. She has a lot of brochures of Writers in the Round that she used to do in the city. This one, of course, is with Towns Van Zandt, Vince Vaill, etc. We also are getting in the John Lomax III collection. There was a brief period of time where he actually was working with Rocky Hill, Dusty Hill's brother, to put out an album. And this is kind of, he had a whole nice little folder about that work that he did with Rocky Hill, and this is one of the photographs from that. And then we have the Bruce Bryant donations, and that includes some videos from a little old show and also some other videos that he produced of folk musicians. And then also there's the Sweetheart of Texas Concert Hall and Saloon poster collection, which is a little place that existed not even a year, but they had a really great lineup. As you can see, Lucinda Williams. And then we have our Houston Folk Music Collection. And what this is just for, let's say that someone gives a donation, but maybe it's like 5 digital images or something like that. It kind of goes into this one. We have quite a few images of Dogtooth Violet. And then we have records, including the Anderson Fair record, Through the Dark Nightly. And this first edition of the Nancy Griffith, There's a Light Beyond These Woods. Then we have our related collections, which include the Rockefeller's Business Records. And that's a really great collection. You can kind of see what happened behind the scenes. There are a lot of contracts and all of their calendars, which are really great, and some good really great photographs. So you may not think Rockefellers and folk music, but actually, like, their first year, it was almost all a Houston lineup. And then Houston favorites like Shake Russell and Dana Cooper would play there all the time. And then we also had the Joseph Lomax collection. John Lomax III gave us his brother's materials. And he was mentioned earlier today. Frank Davis is over there with his daddy banjo. And so there are a couple of things that are folk related that pop up in that. Joseph Lomax's ran a printing press. And that press put out For the Sake of the Song, which was Towns Van Zandt's songbook. And then we have something we're really proud of, which is the Liberty Hall collection. We have about 30 to 35 posters that have been donated. And then we also have a scrapbook of the first 2 years, which includes a lot of photography and news clippings and those kinds of things, a lot of tickets. And we have, and I think other people have this, but the audio of the Bruce Springsteen concert that everyone talks about. And then this that actually is from Craig Calvert, this Towns Van Zandt. Now, it was not recorded in 1984 because the person didn't know what they were writing on it. It's actually from his June 77 concert. And someone basically recorded, KPFT would actually record, and someone recorded that. And so that's what it is. If we could play the clip of Towns Van Zandt, that would be great.
Hey, that's what we're gonna play, Freight Train Blues.
I was born in Dixie in a boomer shack, just a little shanty on the railroad track. Humming at the gravel was my lullaby. The freight train whistle taught me how to cry. I got the freight train blues.
And then we have quite a few upcoming collections. I'm expecting Jack Saunders to come in next week. We also have, and also I'm going to go visit Lynn Lingham when she comes in next week too. And then we have Vince Bell and Vanden Geckos coming in the next few months. So what are our next steps? I really, really want this stuff to be used in the classroom. I want this to be, to people have their hands on it and for students to learn more about this great folk history that occurred here. And so I'm working in conjunction with a professor who has a class on popular music and culture. And they, towards the end of their semester, they actually study subcultures. And they are going to study the subculture of Houston folk, which is really great. And then I'm working on oral histories. So we have the, I already have two up, which are Ryan Trimble and Linda Herrera, of co-founders from Liberty Hall. You can go online and find those. We also have, I'm going to be working on an online exhibit, and then I'll be writing a book chapter on the kind of the alternative outreach that we've been doing. So if you want to learn more, go to Facebook and just look up Houston Folk Music Archive. We are there. And I put updates on there all the time. If you want to learn a little bit more in depth about stuff, there's also the What's in Winston blog. And we have a research guide. And you can go ahead and just look at our, you can look at our finding aids for our inventories. And then you can also see all the books that we've collected and DVDs. And if you need anything else, please contact me. So. Thank you so much.
Can we go ahead and put on the speakers' mics now? Do you guys have any sound? Yep, you have sound now.
We do have about 8 or 9 minutes for questions, so I'd like to entertain questions from the audience for any of our speakers. And please do not be shy. Yes, the gentleman over here. Yes.
DJ Screw, it strikes me, his music to my ears sounds very similar to Jamaican dub music, but who were his, or do you know, his musical influences? Who kind of inspired him to do what he did?
So I don't have a really good answer to that. I know there was another mixtape DJ in Houston whose name, of course, I can't bring to mind. Daryl Scott, thank you, who also did some slowed down music. And that may have been an influence. DJ Screw himself was really into particularly California sort of gangster rap from his time living in California. But, you know, I don't know exactly what it is that made him decide to manipulate.
There's nothing in his documents
that's... Well, his documents are fairly sparse, and there's not like a diary or something that really explains that creative process. There's one documentary in which he's interviewed, and he just says, you know, he was messing around, and he slowed down the pitch control, and the shit sounded good to me. So that's the answer I give.
Julie, I'd like to, could you tell us a little bit about what is in the collection, though, maybe about some of the DAT tapes and what you've done with those? Because I think that's very interesting.
Sure. The collection itself, it's mainly the vinyl records. And then we have, at this point, we have about 14 of the original Screw tapes that we got either from friends of his or from through Screwed Up Records and Tapes. And then also just some small kind of memorabilia that we found when we were taking in his collection. But then we have a related collection called the Samplified Digital Recording Studios Collection, and that's got a little of, it's the records of a recording studio, and they recorded on ADAT, which is an obsolete format, kind of like DAT. And it includes some of DJ Screw and Point Blank collaboration. And we've had a batch of the DJ Screw tapes and all of the ADATs preserved, digitally preserved. So, and those are actually available. If you want to come do research, you can come visit our reading room and listen to those.
And kind of bouncing off that, Nori, can you talk a little bit more about the digitization that y'all are doing kind of hands-on yourself at Rice? Because it's pretty fascinating.
I just kind of did it. I mean, it's basically, yeah, we use that Otari. We have it hooked up to a thing. I forget what that's called. And then use Audacity and record it. And then I go back through, which is really the real work, is that I go back through and I listen to it. And then I describe it. And so that's kind of where the actual, like, I think the labor is. The other, I just, like, kind of pop on the reel and I walk away and then I come back. But it's the listening that I think, which has been really fascinating, sometimes very boring, but very generally very, very fascinating.
And because I imagine a lot of times those tapes come in under-described, so you probably don't even really know what's on them until you listen to them?
Yes. So, for example, we have ones that just say Newsmaster. And those are like some of my favorites, but they are a lot of work because I have to, they're all different news stories. And sometimes it could just be someone's voice and I have to figure out who that person's voice is and try to describe what they're talking about and that kind of thing.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
I think we have time for one or two more questions. We have a question right here with this gentleman.
I guess I could speak to that. So as the side project of Indie Preserves, so my colleague Scott Carlson and I tried to kind of reach out to that community to give them kind of real world steps that they could take to preserve, because I think that, you know, it's just like, let's say you made your favorite mixtape and you didn't label it. And years later, you're like, what is this thing? That's what they're kind of do. That's what some people kind of do with their digital files, right? It'll just be like, take one, take two, take three. And it doesn't mean anything to them in a few years. And it doesn't mean anything to anybody when that person is gone. And so at this point, it's kind of in that musician's court right now, or to kind of start thinking of ways that they could describe their materials better and steps to make sure they don't lose it, so that hopefully when we get it in the future, we'll be able to take care of it.
Nori, where can they find more information about Indie Preserves?
IndiePreserves.info.
All right, we have time for one more quick question. Or not so quick. Hey, we've got one over here.
I have an offering that might be interesting. The archives, online archives of the Houston Press, include an article by John Nova Lomax, in which he traces the history of codeine and Houston music from DJ Screw back to Towns Van Zandt, whose first serious song he wrote was Waiting Round to Die, which ended up being about codeine. And I heard him sing that at Sand Mountain Coffee House quite a few years ago. But there's a lot of history there.
If you,
of course, if you want history, ask the Lomax.
if you talk to people in the Screwed Up Click, they'll always say, like, you know, yeah, we kind of came up with drinking it with Sprite, but, you know, people's mamas were drinking it out of the bottle, you know. And so, yes, they didn't invent drug use. And I'll also give out a shout out to the Houston Press, because that's where I first learned about DJ Screw and that subculture, and it just stayed in my mind until it.
And that was a very interesting way to tie these together. I'm sorry, Frank, what were you saying? Yeah, the codeine in the music goes back a lot further than that. we are about out of time, and in the interest of keeping the conference on schedule, I would like to thank our presenters for being here today, and to thank you guys for listening.